بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك اللهم صل عليك حبيبي يا رسول الله. Today inshallah we're trying inshallah to finish the last part of Tafsir for juzʼ Amma. So inshallah we will be starting with Surah Al-Takathur. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألهاكم التكاثر. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, all are preoccupied by the love of the world, by the love of its delights and its adornments. So this love has made people away from the correct love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This distracts people from seeking the hereafter and from desiring it. And Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talked a lot about the love of dunya, and he said in one of the narrations, لو كان لابن آدم واد من ذهب لتمنى أن يكون له واديان ولا يسد فاه إلا التراب. If the son of Adam owns a valley of gold, he would desire to have two, and nothing will stop him until he reaches his grave. In another hadith, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam يقول العبد مالي مالي وإنما له من ماله ثلاث. So the servant says, my wealth, my wealth. Yet he only gets three benefits from his wealth. ما أكل فأفنى, that which he eats and finishes, أو لبس فأبلى, or that which he wears till it's worn out, أو تصدق فأمضى, or that which he gives in charity and is gone. وما سوى ذلك فذاهب وتاركه للناس. But everything else of his wealth, other than what we mentioned, will go away, and he will leave everything behind, and he will be buried. He will not take anything with him. No one takes his wealth with him to the grave. So ألهاكم التكاثر حتى زرتم المقابر, until you die and you get buried. In a narration, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, يَتْبَعُ الْمُؤْمِنُ ثَلَاثَ يَرْجِعُ اثْنَانِ وَيَبْقَى مَعَهُ وَاحِدٌ. So three things would follow the janazah of a person. Two of these will go back and just one will stay with him. So he will be followed, the janazah will be followed by the relatives and friends, and by his wealth, how rich he is, how fancy the janazah is, how everything has been prepared. And the last thing is his deeds. So two of them would go back, which are the money and the people, the relatives, وَيَبْقَى عَمَلُهُ, and his deeds will stay with him. كَلَّا سَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ. Nay, you shall come to know. Which explains the hadith of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, An-Nasu niyam idha ma matu intabahu. People are just sleeping, they're headless, but when they die, they would know, they would realize the reality. And they will know what they missed. They will know what they should have done. So when a person dies, at that time, they will understand. ثُمَّ كَلَّا سَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ. Nay, again, you shall come to know. This is an emphasis. You non-believers, one day you will know that you were wrong. You believers who did not follow the right path and who went astray and come back and went astray and you were doing bad things here and there, then you will know. Everybody will know exactly what happened what they did and how they will be rewarded or how they will be punished. كَلَّا لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ. Nay, if you knew with certainty of knowledge, if you knew the reality, you wouldn't have been distracted. Nothing would have taken you away from the right path. كَلَّا لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ لَتَرَوُنَّ الْجَحِيمَ. Verily, you shall see the hellfire. Everybody will see the hellfire. Those who are winners, they will know that they are saved and they will be super happy. They will rejoice for being saved. But those who loses the end, well, they will know that their destiny will be the blazing fire. ثُمَّ لَتَرَوُنَّهَا عَيْنَ الْيَقِينَ. And again, you shall see it with certainty of sight. You will see it with your own sight. ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. On that day, you shall be asked about the delights. Allah gave you in your lives, He gave you health, safety, sustenance, wealth. He gave you everything, eyes, hearing, tongue. But you will be asked about these delights. Your eyes, you were not supposed to look at this, you did. You were not supposed to hear this with your ears, and you did. You were not supposed to say these things with your tongue, but you did. So you will be asked. And Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, نِعْمَتَانِ مَغْبُونٌ فِيهِمَا كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ الصِّحَّةُ وَالْفَرَاغِ. الصِّحَّةُ, so two favors are treated unjustly by most people. Health and free time. These are two blessings. These are ni'am. These are the delights that Allah has given us. You will see so a lot of people just wasting time. They say, the only word you will hear from them, oh, I'm bored. I don't know what to do. Be creative. Get closer to Allah. Get closer to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Try to spread the knowledge you know. If you know, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. If you know one ayah, just spread it. Don't waste time. If you are healthy, then use your health. Use this time when you are healthy. Do something beneficial to you, to your family, to your parents, to your friends, to your relatives, to your neighbors. Be good. In Surah Al-Asr, we say that At-Tabari radiallahu anhu narrated, whenever two companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of Allah, so use whenever two companions used to meet, they would not part until one of them had recited Surah Al-Asr. And one of them had given greetings of peace to the other. They would say, Salaam alaikum. So they would, when there is a gathering, try to end this gathering with Surah Al-Asr, with reciting Surah Al-Asr, and give salam before you leave. And Sayyid al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu said, لَوْ تَدَبَّرَ النَّاسُ هَذِهِ السُّورَةَ لَوَسِعَتْهُمْ. If people were to ponder on this surah, it would be sufficient for them. وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Again, this surah starts with a wow, and this wow is the oath wow. So we have an oath here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by time. Time. Asr is time. Between Dhuhr and Asr, Asr is time. So man is in loss. This is what Allah is swearing. Wal Asr, innal insana lafi khusr. Is everyone in loss? No. Illa, except. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Except for those who believe and do righteous things, righteous good deeds. So, almost always the word آمَنُوا is followed by وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. You cannot have just belief without righteous deeds. And you cannot have just righteous deeds without being a Muslim and have good faith. So, man is in loss except for those who believe and do righteous good deeds. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ They encourage, they advise each other to the truth and to the good deeds, to perform, to do a lot of good deeds. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ And also, they advise each other, they encourage each other to practice patience. So they perform acts of obedience and they avoid the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbidden for them. So those people, tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bil sabr, people of Allah, those people who meet for the sake of Allah, those people who love each other for the sake of Allah, they worry about and they care about the ending of their friends, of their companions. They want them to be safe, to be saved. So, tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bil sabr. We can say a few words here about tawasaw bil sabr. When we say the sabr, practicing patience, can be on several things. I will mention three of them. Worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we practice patience for that. What does this mean? We mean that when you want to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let's take the Fajr prayer or the Tahajjud prayer. So if you wake up at night, you want to pray Tahajjud, then Shaitan will immediately whisper, oh, it's cold. Oh, just you see how warm you are. You see, you don't need to wash your hands in cold water or something. Then we need to practice patience. We need to get away, not to listen to this Shaitan, to the whisper of the Shaitan. So we practice patience to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also practice worship to avoid disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, don't backbite. Are we really practicing patience here? Are we really not backbiting each other? This is practicing patience. Also, we practice patience when we have calamities. The good believer, when he has any calamity, he would say, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un." During the loss of dear loved relatives, father, mother, son, husband, children. So we say, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un." Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, when his son died, he was crying, some tears fell off, and he said, "Wallahi." ما نقول إلا ما يرضي الله سبحانه وتعالى or what with his word إنا لله وإنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون إن العين لا تحزن وإن القلب إن العين لا تدمع وإن القلب لا يحزن ولا نقول إلا ما يرضي الله ورسوله the eye will shed tears the heart will feel sorry will have grief but we say nothing but what pleases Allah سبحانه وتعالى إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون So we have to practice patience at the moment. So this is Surah Al-Asr. And in Surah Al-Humazah is the slanderer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ Woe to every slanderer. Who disgraces others. So what's the difference between al-humazah and al-lumazah? Humazah are those who disgrace others with the eye and with the hand. They give just winks, they wink with their eyes, or they give just gestures with their hand. Just some signs. Al-lumazah is to disgrace others with tongue. So backbiting. Saying bad words about others. So this is al-humazah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, woe to those people. There will be big punishment for them. الذي ويل لكل همزة همزة الذي جمع مالا وعددا. Who gathered wealth and counted this wealth. He is so occupied in counting how much wealth he has, how much money he has. He piles up his wealth and he keeps counting it. His heart is connected to it. It's good to be wealthy, but always make the dua, Ya Allah, make this wealth in our pockets and not in our heart. It's good to be wealthy, but it should not distract us from worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or obeying Him. يَحْسَبُ أَنَّ مَالَهُ أَخْلَدَهُ. He thinks that his wealth will make him last forever. He can buy whatever he wants. He thinks that he's not gonna die or... No. كَلَّا لَيُنْبَذَنَّ فِي الْحُطَمَةِ. No, verily, he will be thrown into the hutama. So the next ayah says, وَمَا أَدْرَكَ مَا الْحُطَمَةِ. And what do you know of al-hutama? What is al-hutama? This is one of the descriptive forms of hellfire. It crushes whoever is in it. نار الله الموقدة التي تطلع على الأفئدة. It's the fire of Allah whose heat reaches the heart. Imagine yourself burning your finger, how painful it will be. So just a finger. The hellfire was flamed 50,000 years until it was red, and 50,000 years until it was white, and 50,000 years until it was black, dark. And it will burn them all the way until the heart, until it reaches the hearts. And imagine how painful that will be, and they will still be alive. Severe pain and torture. إِنَّهَا عَلَيْهِمْ مُؤْصَدَ. Verily, it shall hem them in. It will cover them, engulf them, and lock them in forever. So this punishment, this whatever they are facing, whatever they are in, it will never decrease. It's forever. في عمد ممددة إنها عليهم مؤصدة. So it's verily, it shall hem them in pillars stretched forth. So the pillars of fire, there will be columns of fire over them. They will be chained with fire. The gates will be shut upon them, and there is no way out for them. Nothing to help them escape this torture. In Surah Al-Fil, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we all know the story of Abraha when he wanted to destroy Al-Kaaba. We know the reason for this, for his being so upset, and we know that Abraha was the king of Yemen, and he built a church, and he named this church Al-Qulais. So Abraha forced Arabs to make pilgrimage to this Qulais, to his Qulais, instead of going to Kaaba, but they refused. And so to punish him for this, one person went in this church and he relieved himself in the church. So Abraham was so upset. Another person decided, okay, you are doing this, then this structure should not be there. So he got it into fire, and that made Abraham lose his mind. So he swore that he will destroy the Kaaba. So he took a big army with 12 elephants, and he went from Yemen up to Mecca, and he was very close to the Kaaba, but he he was away a little bit, and he, the distance was not far. So he settled there, and he went, he sent his guards to Mecca. And the leader of Mecca at that time was Abdul Muttalib, جد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the grandfather of Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. So his guards captured 200 camels for Abdul Muttalib, and Abraha sent a message to Abdul Muttalib that, look, we didn't come here to fight you, but we came here to destroy the Kaaba, to destroy this house of yours. So if you would let us do that, we will not fight you. Otherwise, we will fight you. So Abdul Muttalib said, we don't want to fight you. Allah, this house, this sacred house has a Lord, and this Lord will, the Lord will protect his house. And he went to see Abraham. Abdul Muttalib was big, handsome. He was respected. And when Abraha saw him coming in, he went down and he left the cushions he was sitting on, and he sat with him on the ground. So Abdul Muttalib said, I want you to send me give me back my camels. And he said, I am the Lord of the camels, and I want you to give it back to me. As for the house, it has a Lord, and this Lord will the Lord will defend his house. So Abraha gave the camels back, and Abdul Muttalib left him and went to the Kaaba, and he took the metal ring of the door of the Kaaba, and he started to make dua. He made dua, and he said, Ya Allah, oh my Lord, this is your property, defend your house. This is your house, defend your house. So the next day, Abraha got prepared, and he wanted to attack the Kaaba, but something happened. The elephant knelt down, and he would not move. They pushed him, they poked him, the elephant would not move. If they made the elephant away from the Kaaba, then he would stand up and start to run. If they make him toward the direction of the Kaaba, then he will kneel down again. And we know that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how he sent birds in groups, and they have the pebbles, and they destroyed the army of Abraha. So let's see what happened. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alam tara kayfa fa'ala rabbuka bi ashabi al-fil. Have you not seen how your Lord dealt with the owners of the elephant? Alam yaj'al kaydahum fi tadlil. Did he not make their plot go astray? He destroyed their plot. They did not get what they planned for. وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلٍ. So their punishment, he sent against them birds in groups, for each group following the other, and each bird carrying three stones in their feet and in their pig. So these stones, these birds, تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِّن سِجِّيلٍ, striking them with stones from clay. So when they would throw these on them, these stones, small stones, will get into their bodies and it will destroy them. فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. Al-asf is the leaves of the crops that are not gathered, so we call this these leaves al-asf, or and al-asf al-ma'kul is the straw when the cattle eat it. They defecate it out, and it becomes dung. So this is how their bodies became. So what happened to Abraha? Abraha was split open, even his heart was exposed, and he was just a lesson to all those who disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, so once we know that in Yawm al-Hudaybiyah, on the day of Hudaybiyah, the she camel of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knelt down. It doesn't want to move. The she camel, she doesn't want to move. And people tried their best, but they couldn't make her move. So they said, some people said, Al-Qaswa'u anida. Al-Qaswa is stubborn. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ما خلأت القصواء وما ذاك لها بخلق ولكن حبسها حابس الفيل. القصواء has not become stubborn. Don't say that about القصواء. And that is not part of her character. But rather, she has been stopped by he who restrained the elephant, Abraham. So now, the Arabs got more honor for this house. And they used to honor the people of Quraysh more. Everyone around the Arabian Peninsula now cares for not harming this group of people. We see in Surah Quraysh, the next surah. So Surah Quraysh is directly related to the previous surah, the Surah Al-Fil. And the meaning of both surahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prevented the animal from entering Mecca and has made this place Mecca sacred. So Allah is saying here, لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ. And we have, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has destroyed the people of the elephant to gather Quraysh. إِلَاف means together. So to gather and to unite Quraysh and to bring them together safely in their city. So إِلَاف, they would gather. How would the people of Quraysh gather? One of the ways they would gather during their journey in the winter to Yemen, they used to take their trade to Yemen. And in summer, they used to go up to Sham because in summer it will be cooler to go up and in winter it will be warmer to go down. So they will go back after getting their trade. They would go back safely on their journey. So people now know these people, know Quraysh. They know that these are people who are protected by Allah. These are the people who are protected by their Lord. So they would honor them and they would not try to harm them. So لإلاف قريش إلافهم رحلة الشتاء والصيف. So we should be amazed by the favors upon Quraysh. So the Arabs now gathered into their journeys, the winter journey and the summer journey. They would go for trading and they would go safely. فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتِ. So let them worship the Lord of this house. Just as he has given them a safe sanctuary and a sacred house. فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتِ الَّذِي أَطْعَمَهُمْ مِنْ جُوعٍ وَآمَنَهُمْ مِنْ خَوْفٍ. Allah, their Lord has protected them against hunger and made them safe from fear. So their trading is always safe. No one can raid on them because they know that These people are protected. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favored them with safety and gentleness. So for this, they should single him out for worship and worship alone, him alone, without any partner. They should not worship any idols beside him. So this is what Quraysh should be doing. Allah has honored them, but they have to return this favor. But what happened when they heard of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Some of them accepted, some of them belied severely and badly. Now we move to Surah Al-Maa'oon. أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ. Ya Muhammad, have you seen the one who denies the hereafter, who denies the recompense and the final reward? فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُّ الْيَتِيمِ. That is the one who oppresses the orphan and does not give him just due. He's not kind to them. فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُّ الْيَتِيمِ. He gets their money. He doesn't have any emotions to them. وَلَا يَحُبُّ عَلَىٰ طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ. And he does not encourage others to feed the needy, to be good to the poor, to feed the poor. So these are two commands from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To feed the needy, to feed the poor, and not to harm the orphans. And we talked earlier about how highly rewarded is the person who takes care of the orphans and who treats them with mercy and with love and kindness. So the one who denies the day after would not do that. كَلَّا بَلْ لَا تُكْرِمُونَ الْيَتِيمِ وَلَا تَحَضُّونَ عَلَى طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ. We saw this ayah, these two ayahs in Surah Al-Fajr, they have the same meaning. فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُّ الْيَتِيمُ وَلَا يَحَضُّ عَلَى طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ. In Surah Al-Fajr, we said in ayah 17-18, كَلَّا بَلْ لَا تُكْرِمُونَ الْيَتِيمِ وَلَا تَحَضُّونَ عَلَى طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ. You don't honor the orphan and you don't care for feeding the poor. فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. Normally when we read these two ayahs, we don't stop after al-musallin, but we connect the two ayahs. Because فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ means woe unto those who perform prayers. So Allah, why would Allah order us to pray and then he would say فَوَيْلٌ or woe to those who perform prayers? No, not all prayers. الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَهُونَ. The people performing their salah is completely outside of its time. So they keep delaying the prayer, until it's not the time for that prayer anymore. So if they pray, they pray out of time. So they are not fulfilling the pillars of this prayer. And Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained that when he said, تِلْكَ صَلَاتُ الْمُنَافِقِ. This is the prayer of the hypocrite. يَجْلِسُ يَرْقُبُ الشَّمْسِ. He stays and just watches the sun, because they used to get to know the time of the prayer per the sun and the shadow. حَتَّى إِذَا كَانَتْ بَيْنَ قَرْنَيِ الشَّيْطَانِ قَامَ فَنَفَرَ أَرْبَعًا. Until when it's at the end of the time, or when the time just passes, he picks his prayer. He doesn't fulfill the pillars of the prayer. وَلَا يَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ فِيهَا إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. He doesn't remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except for just a little bit. But in fact, he doesn't think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he's praying. فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ يُرَاءُونَ. So if they are praying, those, and if they are doing good, whether prayer, for charity, anything, what's their intention? Those who do good deeds only to be seen, only to be praised, only to be well spoken of, but not to gain the reward that Allah has promised. وَيَمْنَعُونَ الْمَعُونَ, and they will withhold the simple, the simplest assistance. They would not help anybody. They would not let let anyone use anything of their stuff, even if they are not using it. If someone asks them for help, they will not offer it. They would reject anything. They would not accept to help anybody. So they do not worship their Lord well, nor they treat his creation well also. Now we move to Surah Al-Kawthar, one of the most amazing surahs in the Quran. So when Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when this surah was revealed, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled. And for us, whenever we read this surah, we smile. Just because Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled, then we smile for reading Surah Al-Kawthar. So Anas radiallahu anhu narrated, while we were with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the masjid, then he dozed off into a slumber. And then he lifted his head smiling. He said, "Oh, Messenger of Allah, what has caused you to smile?" And he said, لَقَدْ أُنزِلَتْ عَلَيَّ آلِفًا سُورَةً. And he read the surah, إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرَ. Verily, a surah was just revealed to me, and he recited that surah. Then he said, "Do you know what is Al-Kawthar?" And everyone said, "Allah and his messenger both know." And he said, فَإِنَّهُ نَهْرٌ وَعَدَنِيهِ رَبِّي. It's a river that Allah has promised me. عَلَيْهِ خَيْرٌ كَثِيرٌ. It has abundant goodness. Now imagine yourself now drinking from this river, from this pond. هُوَ حَوْضٌ. It's a pond. تَرِدُ عَلَيْهِ أُمَّتِي يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. My ummah, my nation, will be brought to this pond on the day of judgment. آنيته عدد النجوم في السماء. Its containers are as numerous as stars. فيختلج العبد منهم. So one servant will be prevented from drinking. فأقول, and I will say, ربي إنه من أمتي. Oh my Allah, he is one of my nation, he is one of my ummah. فيقول الله إنك لا تدري ما أحدث بعدك. You don't know what he introduced or what he innovated, what bad things he has done actually. Ya Allah, we ask you for the best drink from this hold, from this pond, from the hand of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. I will talk more about this kawthar. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, هُوَ نَهْرٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ أَعْطَانِيهِ رَبِّي لَهُوَ أَشَدُّ بَيَاضًا مِنَ اللَّبَنِ وَأَحْلَى مِنَ الْعَسَلِ فِيهِ طُيُورًا أَعْنَاقُهَا فَأَعْنَاقِ الْجُزُرِ. It's a river in paradise which my Lord has given me. It is whiter than milk and sweeter than honey. There are birds whose necks are long, like the necks of camels. Another hadith, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Kawthar nahrun fil jannah, haffatahu min dhahab, wal-ma'u yajri ala al-lu'lu'. Al-Kawthar is a river in paradise whose banks are of gold and it runs over pearls. مَاؤُهُ أَشَدُّ بَيَاضًا مِنَ اللَّبَنِ وَأَحْلَى مِنَ الْعَسَلِ. Its water is whiter than milk and sweeter than honey. So this is what we are looking for, inshallah. فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَالْحَرِ. Therefore, turn in your prayer to your Lord and sacrifice. So perform your obligatory and optional prayers and sacrifice solely for and sincerely for your Lord. Worship Him. When we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worship Him alone and do not associate any partner with Him. And do not let anything in the dunya distract you from your worshiping to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sacrifice pronouncing His name alone. So when you sacrifice for His sake, you say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, and then you slaughter your animal. Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. For he who cuts you, he will be cut off. He who hates you, Muhammad, he and hates what you have come with of guidance, of course, of truth, then he is the most cut off of who will not be remembered. This area was revealed about Al-As bin Wa'il, who was an unbeliever at the time of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So whenever the name of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be mentioned while this person, Al-As, would be present, he would say, leave him, for indeed he is a man who is cut off, having no descendants. They know that his sons died when he was young, so they thought that when he dies, he will not be remembered. Because normally they would say, son, this person is the son of so-and-so, and this son is the son of so-and-so. So he has no sons. When he dies, no one will mention him. So this is what they said. But to the contrary, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved His remembrance for all the world to see. So Allah associated the name of Muhammad with His name, especially in the Azan. Whenever we hear the Azan, we hear Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. So His name will be always mentioned. Why the name Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar? While the name of that person who said this about you, this is the one who will not be remembered. In Surah Al-Kaafiroon, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to recite this surah and Surah Al-Samad, Qul Huwallahu Ahad, in the two rak'ahs of Sunnah Al-Tawaf when he goes around the Kaaba. After he finishes his Tawaf, there is a Sunnah of two rak'ahs, then he would read Surah Al-Kaafiroon in the first rak'ah and Surah Al-Samad in the second rak'ah. And he also read these two surahs in the two rak'ahs before Al-Fajr. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. The non-believers wanted Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to leave this message, to stop calling for this message. So they tried to give him whatever he wants. Just if he wants anything, they will give it to him. If he wants women, they will get him to marry the best, the most beautiful woman in their tribe. If he wants money, they would make him the richest. If, and everything failed. Until one day, one of them said, okay, how about if we worship his, God 1 year and he worship our God 1 year? So Allah revealed, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. Say, O disbelievers, لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ. I worship not that which you worship. I will never worship the statues and your rival gods. ولا أنتم عابدون ما أعبد. Nor you will worship whom I worship. I worship Allah who has no partners. And I will ولا أنا عابد ما عبدتم. And there is an emphasis to this. And I shall not worship that which you are worshiping. ولا أنتم عابدون ما أعبد. Nor you will worship whom I worship. This is an emphasis. I don't follow what you worship. I only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the manner in which He loves and He is pleased with. And you don't follow the commands of Allah, His legislation, His worships. I don't worship you. You don't worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينُ. To you be your religion, and to me my religion. In Surah Yunus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنْ كَذَّبُوكَ فَقُلْ لِي عَمَلِي وَلَكُمْ عَمَلُكُمْ أَنْتُمْ بَرِيئُونَ مِمَّا أَعْمَلُ وَأَنَا بَرِيئٌ مِمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. And if they deny you, just say, unto me my work, and unto you is your work. You are innocent of what I do, and I'm innocent of what you do. So, to you be your religion, your disbelief, and to me my religion, which is Islam. And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given victory to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which we will see in the surah after, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. When there comes the help and the victory from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the conquest. It's the conquering of Mecca. وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. And you saw people entering the religion of Allah in crowds. We all know the story when Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went back to Mecca, conquering Mecca, how the Quraysh became they became worried what will happen to them. Ibn Abbas said, this surah was an indication to the death of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because now Muhammad, the messenger of Allah, his role has been completed. His message is complete now. This is a heavy surah if we go deep into the meaning. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if this happens, if Mecca is conquered, فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ, then praise your Lord and seek forgiveness of Him. إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. He is ever ready to show. He's ever ready to accept one's repentance. So when someone makes anything wrong, when someone does anything wrong, just have a moment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sit alone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Praise Him and ask Him for forgiveness. إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. He's for sure accepting the repentance of a person until he is on his deathbed. So in Surah Tabat, when Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was ordered to call people for da'wah, for the message, he said, oh people, come at once. He went on a mountain, on a hill, and he called, oh people, come at once, oh people, come at once. So Quraysh gathered around him and he said, if I told you that the enemy was going to attack you in the morning or in the evening, would you all believe me? And they said, yes, of course, you are always trustworthy, you are always honest, and you never said a lie. Then he said, فَإِنِّي نَذِيرٌ لَكُمْ بَيْنَ يَدَيْ عَذَابِ الشَّدِيدِ. Verily, I'm a warner sent to you all before the coming of a severe torment. So Abu Lahab said, have you gathered this to say these words? Have you gathered us to say these words? May you perish. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, tabbat yada abi lahabin watab, perished the two hands of Abu Lahab, and perished he. We know Abu Lahab was his Sayyidina Muhammad's uncle, who hated him and who opposed him, who hurt him, who did all his best to try to get him away from Islam and to finish this message that he brought, but of course he couldn't. مَا أَغْنَى عَنْهُ مَالُهُ وَمَا كَسَبْ, his wealth and his children will not benefit him. سَيَصْلَى نَارًا ذَاتَ لَهَبٍ, he will enter a fire full of flames. وَامْرَأَتُهُ حَمَّالَةً حَطَبًا, and his wife too, who carries wood. She would carry wood, she will be helping to administer his punishment in fire of hell. She will carry the firewood and throw it upon her husband to increase what that which he is in torment. Of course, she was as bad as him. في جيدها حبل من مسد, in her neck, a twisted rope of mesad, from the palm fiber of the fire. She used to place thorns into the path of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and for that Allah will place a collar of iron, of fire, on her neck on the Day of Judgment. So we come now to Surah Al-Ikhlaas, the purity, the sincerity. Aisha radiallahu anha says in one of the narrations, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent a leader on a small army to somewhere. So he used, this leader used to lead the people for prayer, and he would mention, he would always read Qul Huwallahu Ahad. So they mentioned that to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Sayyidina Muhammad said, okay, ask him why does he do that? So that companion said, لِأَنَّهَا وَصْفٌ لِلرَّحْمَنِ وَأَنَا أُحِبُّ أَنْ أَقْرَأَهَا, and he said, it contains the attributes of Allah and I love to read it. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَخْبِرُوهُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يُحِبُّهُ, inform him that Allah the Most High loves him. Sayyidina Bilal also used to love this surah and he used to read it a lot. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says about the virtue of Surah Al-Ikhlas, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ إِنَّهَا لَتَعْدِلُ ثُلُثَ الْقُرْآنِ, by he in whose hand is my soul, verily it's equivalent to a third of the Qur'an. And one time Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was with his companions and he said, أَيَعْجَزُ كُلُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَن يَقْرَأُ ثُلُثَ الْقُرْآنِ فِي لَيْلَةِ, can't anyone of you read one third of the Qur'an in one night? And they said, oh ya Rasulullah, is that possible? He said, أَيَعْجَزُ أَحَدُكُمْ أَن يَقْرَأَ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ, is it difficult for any one of you to read Surah قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ? So try to read this surah at least once before you go to bed. Allahu Samad, Allah the eternally bestowed of all, Allah the eternal refugee. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ, he beget not, nor was begotten. He neither begets, nor he is born. Anything that's born is going to die. Allah is not going to die. Allah was not born. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ, and there is none comparable unto him. Nor is there to him any equivalent. So, actually, Surah Al-Samad is one of the surahs of Aqidah that if we want to talk about, books can be read about. Books have been written about. Hours and hours and hours have been spent just explaining Surah Al-Samad. And now we move to the last two surahs, Surah Al-Falaq and Surah Al-Naas. We all know that Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, someone did magic on Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we will see what happened. But just one word about sorcery. Whenever there is sorcery done on people, and when they feel that this thing happened to them, let them just read these two surahs. There is something not right from within. They would feel that there is something not right from within themselves. They would feel that there is so much burden inside themselves. They would feel that they are not themselves, actually. So they have to read Surah Al-Falaq and Surah An-Nas. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Allah is saying part of the manifestation what he has created actually causes harm. So قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ. Seek refuge from the Lord of what? The Lord of daybreak. مِنْ شَرِّ مَا خَلَقَ. From the evil that which he created. So we know that there are some animals that would cause you harm, not because they are bad, but because it's their nature. The lion, the snake, everyone runs away from them because of their nature, not because they are bad creatures. But people won't run away from a cow or from a sheep, from a cat, unless they are afraid of the cat, of course. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did that for animals. Why? Because some of them are just for you to, they are just gentle and in nature, and some of them are harsh in nature. So that's why some of the creatures of Allah have evil in their nature, but not because they are evil. They do bad things, but not because they are evil. So قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا خَلَقَ وَمِنْ شَرِّ غَاسِقٍ إِذَا وَقَبَ. And from the evil of darkness when it settles. So غاسق is a layl, the night. Waqab means when its darkness covers everything. So there will be a veil. No light. Animals, fearful animals will wander here and there at night. Robbers will be practicing their hobbies at night. And so وَمِنْ شَرِّ غَاسِقٍ إِذَا وَقَبَ وَمِنْ شَرِّ النَّفَّاثَاتِ فِي الْعُقَدِ. So what is this? From the evil of the blowers in the knots they tie, and this is referring to sorcerers. So وَمِنْ شَرِّ حَاسِدٍ إِذَا حَسَدَ. And from the evil of an envier when he envies. سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم says العين تدخل الجمل في القدر وتدخل الرجل القبر. Envying, the eye that envies would lead a jamal, a camel, to be slaughtered and to be in a pot to be cooked, and will get someone to die. So envying is a sickness. The one who practices envy, who is envious, he feels so sad, so unhappy. If someone has any blessing, he wants everything, all blessings for himself only. But when we see blessings over people, we say Bismillah, MashaAllah, Tabarakallah. And we do ghibta. Ghibta is the good envy. To ask Allah to keep the ni'mah, to keep the blessing on that person, and to ask for similar thing for yourself. We know that Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a spell or a magic spell has been cast on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by Labid al-Asam. And he Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not feel okay for a few days. Until one day he made dua, Ya Allah, Allah, what is that? So he slept and had a dream of two angels. One of them was at his head and the other one at his feet. One of them asked the other, what ails him? And the other one said, bewitched, he is bewitched. And the first angel asked, who bewitched him? And the second answered, Labid ibn al-Aqsam, that was the name of the one who bewitched Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, with what? He said, with a comb and with traces of her that fells with when someone uses the combs. قَالَ فِي مِشْطٍ وَمُشَاطَ وَجَدْ فِي طَلْعَةِ ذَكَرْ and a male palm tree. قَالَ فَأَيْنِ where? Where's that spell? Well, where did he hide it? And he said, قَالَ فِي بِئْرِ دَارْوَانَ تَحْتَ رَعُوفَةِ الْبِئْرِ in the well of Darwan, under a rock in the bottom of the well. So Rasulullah woke up and he said, Ya Aisha, I feel that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told me what happened. And he went with his companions to the well, and they took the spell, and there was a cord with some knots. And whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this surah with Surah An-Nas, the one after, and whenever he would read these two surahs, one of the knots would untie until everything was untied, and Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam felt relieved immediately. So what's the difference between this surah and Surah An-Nas? So this surah is about, Surah Al-Falaq is about protecting yourself from the physical harm that afflicts you, while Surah An-Nas is about protecting yourself from the spiritual harm that may afflict you. So Surah Al-Falaq talks about the body physically is being protected, and Surah An-Nas is the protection from the shaitan and his whisper. So what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in Surah An-Nas? He said, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, say I seek refuge in the Lord of mankind. مَلِكِ النَّاسِ, the supreme, the dominant of mankind. إِلَهِ النَّاسِ, the God of mankind. مِنْ شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ, from the evil of the whisperer. Retreating whisperer. So the whisperer, the one who whispers, is the shaitan. الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ. So this shaitan is the origin of all evil. So he would whisper to people so they would consider the bad good. He will make the evil good. الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ, he will whisper evil into the breasts of mankind. مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ, so it's not from the jinn and mankind. So it's not only shaitan, it's always the shaitan of the human beings. The bad companions whisper to a good person to go with them to so and so bad place. They would whisper them to do this and this bad thing. So these are the shaitan of An-Nas and the shaitan of the jinn. With this, we come to the end of our journey. We come to the end of our series. Subhanallah. Ya Rabbi, laka alhamdu kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhika wa azimi sultanik. Ya Allah, we ask you, we thank you for all your bounties, Ya Arhamar Rahimin, Ya Rabbal Alameen, wa sallallahumma ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Wa assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you all for attending, and thank you all for those who are listening after this session. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.